Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. On today's show, Israel declares itself a Jewish state. What does that mean for a two-state solution? I talk with Israeli historian Arnon Dagani. Stay with me. Thought I'd slow things down a little and talk about Israel's parliament passing a new law that will characterize Israel as principally a Jewish state. And we'll discuss it with a PhD candidate. He's about 2 weeks away from getting his doctorate. His name is Arnon Dagani, and he joins us today from Los Angeles. Hello, Arnon.
Hi, David.
Thank you for joining us. You're a listener to the show, and you wanted to come on and set me straight about Israel.
Yeah.
Arnon will be a doctor, not a medical doctor to make his mother happy, but a doctor of history from UCLA. You just have to finish up your thesis. And when will it be done?
Yes.
When will it be done?
I'm writing the conclusions right now.
You're writing the conclusions. And I watched some of your lectures on YouTube, and I want to put you in a box so our listeners know who you are, and then you'll educate us about the relationship between the Jews and the Arabs in the West Bank and Gaza, and then the Arabs who live, work, and vote in Israel proper. We'll talk about the history of Israel, and you seem to be a reactionary. By reactionary, I mean you want to return to the vision of the founders of Israel 70 years ago. We're celebrating the 70th anniversary of the founding of Israel. Is that a fair statement, that you think Israel has lost its way and needs to return to its original values?
That is a fair statement, but very much like the U.S., where the original founders had good ideas, they were also implicated in some of the bad things this country was created on, such as slavery. I just see a lot of sense and a lot of benefit that Israelis could gain from seeking those original, some of these original patterns, and without being blind to the grave injustices that this generation committed
towards the Arabs.
Yes, towards the Arabs, towards non-Ashkenazi Jews.
Ashkenazi Jews are the European Jews, the Sephardim are the wandering Jews, the Jews from Morocco, the Jews from Africa. I don't know if they're I don't know if you would call them.
I don't know if they're wandering, but yes, they're from North Africa, from Yemen, from Iraq. But in any case, I am sort of a reactionary by finding sincere, democratic, you could say liberal, bent in early Israel. Of course, without any intentions of saying that it was some sort of utopian, egalitarian society. But those earlier leaders had the good sense of keeping things ambiguous to the point where you could still integrate non-Jewish communities into the Israeli society, which is the opposite of what is happening right now.
This is America, and it's a Manichaean discourse in America. Explain what Manichaean means.
Binary, like it's either this or that. So
yes, and you come from a parliamentary system where it's fluid.
But there is left or and right. I think that in that sense, I belong to the left.
Right. So there's more room for nuance in Israel, and there are 20 sides to every argument. But my listeners, Americans, we see things with no shades of gray.
Right.
So it's like black or white. So let's put you in a box, okay? So my listeners can understand who you are and where you're coming from, what your point of view is, okay? And then you'll explain to us some, you'll teach us, okay?
I'll do my best.
Okay, how old are you?
36.
Where were you born?
Israel.
Where were your parents born?
Israel, Palestine.
Where were their parents born?
A lot of Poland and Northern Italy.
Practicing Jew or a secular Jew?
I'm secular. I'm militantly secular.
Did you serve in the army?
Yes.
What was your rank?
First sergeant, and I served in, I was a grunt, I served in the infantry.
In the infantry, and you served in the West Bank?
Yes, a lot of West Bank.
What year?
2000 till 2003. But I have done the standard occupation of Palestine, as is kind of depicted in news. I was there. I was it.
You were stationed in the West Bank.
Yes.
And that's considered occupied territory. It's what the Israelis got in 67 after the war. They took it from Jordan.
Right.
Did you participate in the destruction of homes that belong to terrorists? If somebody blew themselves up in Israel, it was practice at that time to then destroy the homes of the survivors of that family.
I wasn't present in one of those, but it was a standard practice. It had I been called to assist in that, I would not have disobeyed the orders. It's not something that Israel is hiding in terms of as a policy.
Okay. When you were serving in the military in the early aughts, there was an epidemic of Palestinian kids blowing themselves up on buses in Israel proper.
Right.
A wall was built.
Right.
It was designed by Ehud Barak.
Partially, yeah.
The wall separates the West Bank from Israel proper.
Yes.
The human rights violations notwithstanding, has the wall worked to pretty much eliminate suicide bombing in Israel?
I think it has helped. I think also a strategic decision by the terrorist organizations to stop that type of attack. And it's announced. It's something that they've decided in the mid-aughts to refrain or to practice less. And just to be accurate, the wall, the outline of the wall, doesn't neatly separate the West Bank from Israel proper. The wall makes very significant intrusions into the West Bank.
Okay, I understand that, but what I'm asking you is, there was almost this existential crisis that was going on in Israel in the aughts when it came to...
Early aughts, it was a tough time, for sure.
Suicide bombs.
Yes.
How do you stop it? How do you stop it? And you're crediting Hamas and the Palestinian Authority for no longer funding suicide bombing? You're not saying...
No. But as a military tactic, they realize that it does them harm maybe more than it does any good. And right now, they're refraining. It's sort of like a ceasefire. It's a strategic Palestinian decision.
And you give no credit to the wall. You don't think the wall...
I do give credit to the wall. Because
What percentage of the suicide bombings going down can be attributed to the wall? And what can be attributed to a strategic decision on behalf of the...
I can't answer that. I'm not that kind of...
How easy is it for a Palestinian who wants to blow himself up to sneak across from Gaza or the West Bank? Those are basically the two territories that belong to the Palestinians. How easy would it be for somebody to strap dynamite to themselves or plastique, sneak across the border and blow themselves up?
Probably not that easy, and probably the wall, because anyone who'd want to do that would need some strategic help, some logistical help, sorry. The more people that are in on a secret, in on the mission, then the more chances that Israeli intelligence will catch up on them and stop this from happening. And that's why...
I'll get to that in a second. Let's just stay here for a second. This is good. Thank you for... This is valuable. They need help from within Israel for a suicide bombing to be successful, because a terrorist, a Palestinian, cannot sneak across the border wearing plastique or whatever they use. They have to be fitted with it once they arrive in Israel proper. And to refresh my listeners' memories, there are two Palestinian territories in Israel. One is the West Bank and the other is Gaza, and they're not connected. And the West Bank is larger. It's more peaceful right now. It is up against Jordan. There is a wall that separates the West Bank from Israel proper. So you're saying that a Palestinian terrorist who wants to blow himself up on a bus in Jerusalem would need help from somebody within Israel proper.
Not necessarily. I didn't say that. It has happened a few times. Look, again, this isn't... I'm sorry, David, counterterrorism and how to deal with insurgency and military tactics. That's not my forte, I have to admit.
Okay, I'm getting to a point here. Okay. And your thesis that you're working on.
Okay. Israel, I'll do my best to answer.
Okay. Israel proper.
Right.
How many people live in Israel if you take out the West Bank and Gaza?
I think approximately 9 million.
How many non-Jews, how many Arabs live in Israel proper as citizens?
About 22%, something like that. Yes. Just above 20%.
Have we found that the 22%, those Arab citizens of Israel, serve as a fifth column for Palestinian terrorists? Do they aid and abet suicide bombers in Israel proper?
By and large, no.
Why is that?
That is a great question. That is where I feel like I have the authority to answer that.
That's right. I was building to Excellent. This.
So the Arabs in Israel, and many of them will now identify as Palestinians who live in Israel, not just Arabs. And many of them will reject the category of being called an Arab Israeli, right? Nevertheless, despite discrimination and despite their solidarity with their brethren in the West Bank, they are Israeli citizens. They're part of Israeli society. There's interaction with them on a daily basis in several cities and several locales. They speak Hebrew. Unfortunately, most Israelis don't speak Arabic. They're Israelis.
Do they vote?
To a large extent.
Do they vote?
Of course.
Do they serve in the Knesset, which is the Congress?
Yes, they serve in the Knesset.
Is it conceivable that an Arab who is not Jewish could end up serving as prime minister? Or are there laws on the books preventing?
As days are passing, every day that's passing, it's less and less conceivable. And that's what's problematic about this law.
And what is the law? It was passed by the parliament, so it's officially enacted now?
Yes. Maybe there's some sort of procedure, but it's done.
Right. And so what does the law say?
The law, almost all of its clauses are rather benign, I'd have to admit. It's some sort of, what's the official anthem of the state? What are the official statewide holidays, Jewish holidays? The Hebrew calendar is officially recognized. Stuff that have been the lived reality for everyone living in Israel for the last 7 years.
Okay, so let me stop you there for 1 second, because we study the Constitution, the United States Constitution, on this show. Israel is now officially 70 years old. They don't have a constitution. Like Great Britain, there is no Israeli constitution, right?
Right.
It's a series of laws and norms that dictate the behavior.
Right.
It was never officially a Jewish state. It was kind of a de facto Jewish state, but not a pro forma Jewish state. Does this law make it a pro forma Jewish state?
I'm sorry that I'm constantly trying to tease out the nuance and not go into the binary, but it was officially a Jewish state, and it remains officially a Jewish state.
What do you mean officially?
Well, first of all, like I said, there was a Declaration of Independence. It's a document that has some sort of central gravitas in the culture and even in legal discourse, in Supreme Court decisions. And that officially declares Israel as a Jewish state. It is a norm to consider it a Jewish state. It appears in the symbols. It's everywhere. The reason that there will always be ambiguity of what it means to have a Jewish state, right? I mean, it's not as if you can find some sort of manual given from God about how the Jewish state should behave. By the way, also, Jewish religion is part, I mean, there are aspects of Jewish religiosity that enter into daily life in Israel. If you want to get married, you have to get married with a rabbi. Public transportation is closed on Sabbath. There's a lot of Jewish official aspects to the state that if you combine them together, even before this law, you can say, well, that's a Jewish state.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So this law, more than anything, kind of put in one concise document that was also drafted for the purposes of clarifying to whoever isn't Jewish that this state isn't really yours.
So you're against that?
I'm very much against that.
From what I've seen of your lectures, and I guess this is your thesis, you believe there needs to be some kind of truth and reconciliation, that American Jews and Israeli Jews need to look at their past and take responsibility for the injustices that the nation of Israel has inflicted on the Arabs, the indigenous Arabs who were already living in Palestine, and then the ones who were warehoused in Lebanon, Gaza, and Jordan after Israel declared its independence.
Yeah, I don't see any way this could get significantly better if there isn't some sort of reconciliation and some sort of admitting of wrongdoing and apologizing for it. I'm convinced that that is... By the way, apologies are very cheap. I don't think it will cost us that much.
Well, actually, they're not cheap in the Jewish religion. You just don't...
right, actually. Right.
According... Well, in all seriousness, you just can't say you're sorry. You have to ask three times for forgiveness.
Wow.
Did you know that?
Yeah, I know that.
American Jews and Americans only really get the AIPAC version of Israel. AIPAC is the big Jewish... They're not really a lobby. They are referred to as a lobbyist, but they're really not. But we get the AIPAC version, which is the Likud version of events. And Likud is the far-right wing party in Israel. Bibi Netanyahu is Likud. J Street is a kind of new lobbying group that represents, for lack of a better word, labor, the labor party in Israel. Is that fair?
Maybe labor and the party left of that, which is, you know, it would be in the U.S. would be the equivalent of the maybe, I don't know, Sanders camp within the Democratic Party, I would guess.
So if you were only pay attention to the conversation in Washington, D.C., you would assume that 99% of Jews in Israel are tough on Iran, tough on the Palestinians, and want a military surveillance state in Israel, that they're right wing. But that's not true. It's 50-50. Israel is moving more to the right, but there's an actual conversation going on in Israel about the Palestinians and Iran that Congress here in the United States is not having.
Yes. I wish it was 50-50. I think the right wing is very much dominant right now. The undemocratic right wing, the one that passed this law, is very much dominant.
15 years ago, there was room for nuance. Ariel Sharon, who was Likud, and he was, as I understood it, the toughest Jew. I mean, one of the most despised military heroes. The liberal Jews hated Ariel Sharon, but before he went into a coma, he was moving to the left. He had created his own party, pulled out of Gaza, and may have ended up doing what Rabin had wanted, right?
Gaza Strip, he cleared Gaza Strip from every single Jew living there. That's something that a lot of left-wingers could not have done.
It was his Nixon go to China move.
Maybe. Yeah. Except, you know, this isn't just a diplomatic maneuver. People's houses were demolished. This is a big deal.
Jewish houses were demolished. Yeah.
The way he saw it is that, you know, it's cutting one leg to keep the rest of the body healthy or whatever. I think he had a lot of predatory ambitions But anyways, he coveted a lot of the land in the West Bank, and he thought that the better way to consolidate Israel's control over the most of the West Bank is possible if we gave up Gaza. Because Gaza, let me tell you something about Gaza, just a small anecdote. Gaza, before Israel pulled out, had 1.25 million Palestinians and had 9,000 Jews. So that's less than 1% of Jews inside this one territorial unit. How much land the Jews control in the Gaza Strip?
I don't know.
22%.
22%.
The Jewish settlements in the West Bank that had 9,000 residents in them at most controlled roughly more than 20% of the entire landmass of the Gaza Strip. So the injustice, the problematic status quo in Gaza was much more striking than maybe the West Bank. And so it was kind of obvious that's unsustainable. Mm-hmm. I think Israeli control in the West Bank is unsustainable, but maybe it's easier to manage for a few years. But Gaza Strip was kind of, it was a joke.
Mm-hmm. Do you think there should be a two-state solution, or do you think that there should just be a state of Palestine that includes Gaza and the West Bank, and the Israeli Jews become a minority eventually?
I think I don't have to be honest. I don't really know what's the best move forward. I don't have this kind of 12-point plan roadmap of how to make the situation better. I do think that allowing Palestinians self-sovereignty in the form of an independent state as a transition phase for when Israelis and Palestinians, Jews and Arabs can maybe overcome a lot of the bad blood in the last 100 years. And then we can talk about some sort of federative solution, mutual recognition of rights in each territory, and perhaps maybe one democratic state at the end that's binational or follows a binational principle of being both Jewish and Palestinian.
Okay. Let me ask you a gut question. And this is unfair, but let me ask you a question that Americans would respond to. Mm-hmm. Did the Palestinians lose World War II? Forget the War of Independence 70 years ago. Did the Palestinians lose World War II? Did the Mufti side with Hitler? Was he aware of the concentration camps?
Maybe. I don't know. Look, the Mufti sided with Hitler, full stop.
The question I'm asking, I this sounds very aggressive, and I apologize.
Right.
But did the Palestinians lose World War II? Did they pick the wrong side during World War II? Did they side with Hitler? Did they assist Hitler?
In as much as they is the Mufti, then yes. It did not benefit the Palestinian national movement to pick the losing side and the one that was committing mass genocide at that.
Should there be consequences to picking the wrong side during World War II?
Well, whether or not there should be or there shouldn't, I think there was. That's a fact. I think the fact that, you know, the British controlled Palestine at the time, Israel-Palestine.
Do we know what would have happened had Hitler won? What would have happened to the Jews in Palestine had Hitler won?
As a historian, I'm not supposed to play these games, but I can tell you it's probably not good things.
Not good things.
Yeah. You are pointing out facts. The Mufti fled, met with Hitler, I think helped him with Bosnian Muslim soldiers that collaborated with the Nazis. That is a fact. The fact that there was not a lot of love between the Palestinian National Movement and the British Empire, which was fighting Hitler at the time, and so that created some sort of confluence of interest between Nazi Germany and the Palestinians, that is also a fact. To go and say that basically World War II was fought, on the one hand, it was the Allies, and on the other hand, it was the Axis, which was Germany, Italy, Japan, and the Palestinians, which is starting to be the right-wing narrative here, as if the Palestinians have some sort of direct responsibility for the annihilation of European Jewry. That is ahistorical. It's Holocaust denying.
It's just, and it's
there's
also
no need to go there.
There's no. We don't even do it to the Germans. We don't. apply collective guilt to the German people for the Holocaust.
Yeah, so exactly.
So you can't apply collective guilt to the Palestinians. But as an American,
especially when such guilt is uncalled for.
Okay.
Really.
As an American, and I'm filtering it through the lens of, you know, we're a militaristic country and we fight wars all the time.
Wonder how that's like.
Yeah. The difference is Israeli wars have a beginning, middle, and an end.
Oh, really?
Well, yeah. You have operations and they... Israel is not at war with Lebanon right now. It's not at war with Syria. It's not at war with Egypt. It's not at war with Jordan. It's not at war with Saudi Arabia. It's not at war with Iraq. These are countries that Israel fought wars with, and they're over. They have stopped.
But we are fighting the 48 war. This is still...
Okay. But those wars ended.
That war, the 48 war, sometimes it goes on a hiatus, but...
Right, but it is a myth to say that Israel is in a constant state of war with its neighbors. It's not. It's not at war with Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia won't admit it, but they're pretty much on the same side when it comes to Iran.
I mean, again, I'm sorry to always be pulling things out of the historian's hat, but Israel, for instance, fought Lebanon in 82, mm-hmm. and then withdrew completely from Lebanon only in 2000 when we realized it took 18 years to realize how stupid it is to stay in the territory that you've been dealing with an enemy from and thinking you can manage that territory in a way that would fit your interests. And soldiers came in body bags, a few every week, until Israel realized it just makes no sense to have perpetual war for 18 years. So, I mean, our war is also drag.
Well, but then again, with Lebanon, is Lebanon a country or a collection of nation states? I mean, you have Nasrallah, who is Hezbollah. He's taken over territory in Lebanon. So, I mean, Lebanon has been fractured by civil war. And was Israel fighting a war against Lebanon proper? Or was it at one time fighting a war against the Palestinians who were living there?
Right.
Then were they fighting a war against Hezbollah, which is stationed there? Those are foreign actors who have set up shop in Lebanon.
It's very similar, though. We're not here to fight the Iraqi people. We're here to fight the terrorists. They're kind of the same.
Okay.
And again, there's two wars in Lebanon. The second Lebanese war did take around a summer to fight. That was it. The first one, you could say that it took 18 years.
Okay. For more of my conversation with Israeli historian Arnon Dagani, I invite you to visit me over at davidfeldmanshow.com. I have a contact button. I'm sure you have some comments. From the KPFK studios in Southern California, I'm David Feldman, Medicare for All.